Well, welcome to this afternoon's proceedings. I'm going to hand over to Dr. Tim Keogh, who's going to introduce the Honourable Mark Dreyfus, and just to say that he will be staying for the panel, which is terrific because he's a busy politician. So we thank him very much. I'll be introducing Tim and the others later on in the day.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pamela. Hope you all had a pleasant lunch. Sorry it was a little bit rushed, but it is important that we keep to time. It is, in fact, now my pleasure and privilege to introduce to you the Honourable Mark Dreyfus, QC. Mr. Dreyfus is the Member for Isaacs, Shadow Attorney General, Shadow Minister for National Security, and also Deputy Manager of Opposition Business in the House. So I'm sure he keeps pretty busy. Just some background, that Mark was elected to Parliament in 2007 as the Member for Isaacs, and he'd studied arts and law at the University of Melbourne. He was also a former director of the Law Council of Australia, and he served on the Victorian Bar Ethics Committee and the Bar Council in Victoria. In 1999, he was appointed as a Queen's Counsel, and during his time in February 2013, he was sworn in as Attorney General and Minister for Emergency Management, and in March 2013, took on the additional responsibilities of Minister for the Public Service and Integrity and Special Minister for State. So it's a very busy portfolio. In 2013, he was appointed to the positions of Shadow Attorney General and Shadow Minister for the Arts. He's been a leading figure against the Abbott Turnbull's government's cuts to arts funding and its attempts to scrap, importantly, the Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act. So, as I said, it's my pleasure and privilege to welcome Mark Dreyfus to you.
Thanks very much for that very long introduction, undeserved. If I could start by acknowledging the custodians of the land on which we meet, the Woiwurrung people of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to their elders past and present, and acknowledge their continuing culture and the contribution that they make to the life of this city and this region. Thanks very much for the invitation to speak at this conference. I'm tempted to say now for something completely different. I came a bit earlier today simply to see if I could get a sense of what was being spoken about here, and I'm going to sound a lot drier. I'm a practicing politician. I'm going to talk about the politics and legal framework in which recognition is currently being considered and how we might start to get somewhere with it. Could I thank my good friend Pamela Nathan and the organisers of this conference, as well as this morning's speakers. I didn't hear the first two, but I heard the next. And perhaps I should also acknowledge my colleague and friend, Senator Patrick Dodson. I'm, in a sense, the warm-up act for Patrick, who's following me. He won't like me saying that. As I said, I'm here to talk about the political and legal path to achieving constitutional recognition for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders and the strong leadership that I think is necessary to achieve that change. It was good to hear Kenny Lechleitner talk about the hooks, I think was the phrase that he used, the hooks that we need to hang new laws on. And if I could take that in a sense as my starting point, the reason why we are engaged in this recognition of Indigenous people in the Constitution, the reason why we are engaged in amending, changing our Constitution, is precisely because that document was and is the founding document of our nation. Now, I use both tenses there because, of course, it was the founding document. It's what Australia is based on. It gives us the legal framework for our federation. It brought the brought the six colonies together. It has continued to set the rules under which we govern ourselves. But that was then. It still is our founding document in a rolling sense, because it's what governs the way in which the Commonwealth Parliament makes laws, it's what governs the way in which judges go about their work, it's what governs the relationship of the Commonwealth with the states on an ongoing basis. And it's actually up to us to change that founding document to reflect the kind of Australia that we are and the kind of Australia that we want to be. And it's because it's the framework that provide the hooks that Kenny Leckleitner was talking about that it's so important that we get it right. I do think that we have been missing strong leadership on this point, and I don't think it's going to happen without stronger leadership than has been shown in the last 2 or 3 years. Just to give you an example, Australia endured the terrible doctrine of terra nullius for 200 years. But when the High Court finally acted to get rid of it, Paul Keating, as Prime Minister, grabbed the opportunity to give our nation a legislated regime of native title. We need the same drive and leadership that Keating showed then if we are to achieve constitutional recognition now. Because, as I probably don't need to remind anyone in this room except perhaps the younger people, Keating's native title reforms were resisted strongly with a deeply dishonest scare campaign launched not only by extreme right fringe dwellers, but also by elements within the Liberal Party itself. I strongly believe that now, some 25 years later, the support for change is there, both among the Australian people and across much of the political spectrum. We've worked hard to get to this point. We've fought against the Conservatives, who sought to minimise the changes that are necessary to achieve real recognition. And I think the case has been made for substantive change to the sections of the Constitution that currently enable discrimination against Indigenous people. It's been a long journey. The Bringing Them Home report of 1997, which showed a path to justice for the stolen generation, ignited a push for reconciliation. I'll digress for a moment to say that I worked on the stolen generation case, and one of the reasons why I accepted the brief was that I thought that while the case itself was a very difficult piece of litigation, it was something that would have, even if we lost the case, which we did, have a tremendous political significance in Australia. And I would like to think that in keeping the spirit of that Bringing Them Home report of Sir Ronald Wilson and the Human Rights Commission alive for a number of years after Howard had rejected the recommendations, or most of the recommendations of that report, we did the right thing by bringing that piece of litigation and arguing it through a single judge of the Federal Court, the full Federal Court, and then to the High Court. As I said, that Bringing Them Home report, the effort that was made on behalf of the stolen generation, ignited a push for reconciliation, and I'm sure that everyone here can remember the huge crowds that marched for reconciliation in 2000, the marches across the Sydney Harbour Bridge, down St Kilda Road here in Melbourne, and in many other places. And most of you will remember what I would call the lost Howard years, with a Prime Minister stonily refusing to apologise. I thought that the momentous apology given by Prime Minister Rudd on my first day in the Federal Parliament in 2008 would speed up the push for constitutional recognition, but progress has been achingly slow. Progress which has been made since then is the result of the tireless campaigning of the Indigenous community and supporters across Australia. In particular, the lobby group Recognise, which was set up to promote a referendum. The role of Recognise is an important one because they raise general awareness of the need to end the exclusion of Indigenous people from the Constitution and to change its discriminatory nature. There are hundreds of thousands of people who have already signed up to the Recognise campaign who will rise to the occasion if and when the public debate for the referendum needs it. Recognise's role in raising awareness continues to be vital because without it, we won't see the groundswell that's necessary to achieve a yes vote. but I really want to emphasise the complexity of referendums in Australia and the need for both a push from the community and the strong political leadership which is needed to respond to that change. Labor in government knew that it would be extremely difficult to hold a successful referendum, and that's why, under the leadership of Julia Gillard, in whose government I served briefly as Attorney General, we established an expert panel on constitutional recognition of Indigenous Australians. We did so because achieving any constitutional change in Australia is a journey on a hard road. I'm just going to give you some of the dreadful stats in a minute, but one of the reasons I'm speaking about this is because we can talk all we like about the importance of recognition. We can talk all we like about the impact that recognition would make, and I doubt that there's a single person in this room who does not support the idea of recognition and indeed understands, all of you, why it's important for the kind of Australia that we want to be. But we're not going to get there without a successful constitutional referendum. And the brutal truth of this is that only six of 44 proposed changes that have been put to Australians since 1901 have been successful. The last successful referendum was in 1977, which is 40 years ago. Since then, there have been attempts made to change the constitution in 1984, in 1988, they were both efforts made under the Hawke government, and in 1999, which was the Republic referendum, and all of them failed. The 1988 referendum was particularly startling to me because it was under the cover, if you like, of the bicentennial celebrations. The four questions that were put to the Australian people in that 1988 referendum were, to my mind, unexceptional things, like extending the right to trial by jury and requiring that the states acquire property only on just terms, which is the same obligation that the Commonwealth has under the Constitution, and a couple of other pretty unexceptional propositions. All of them failed. They failed so badly in 1988 that there wasn't a majority in even one state. So that's the level of difficulty. The Republic, perhaps you might say, stands in its own category, but I mention these failed attempts just to show how hard it is. You can put it another way, every decade since 1901 there was at least one referendum up to 2000. Between 2000 and 2010 we had our first decade in the Federation's history without a referendum, and we're well down the track to a second decade without any referendum, not just not a successful one, but no referendum. So in a very real sense, the project, if you can call it, of looking at our constitution, amending it in ways that make it match the Australia that we live in, has stalled. And it's against that level of difficulty that this project of a referendum to change the constitution, to recognise Indigenous people, and to take out the racist references in the Constitution has to be considered. In truth, the case for constitutional change has never been harder. So starting the process with an expert panel seemed useful then, and I think it has been. On the 16th of July 2012, the expert panel presented their report to former Prime Minister Julia Gillard, and the expert panel told us that significant common ground exists across the political spectrum on this issue, and that the options outlined in that report are capable of succeeding. They told us that, and I quote, "It's now for the government and the parliament to take the panel's recommendations forward." Leading up to the election in 2013, there appeared to be bipartisan support for constitutional recognition, but even with this goodwill, the recognition referendum has become bogged down. After the September 2013 election, Prime Minister Tony Abbott set an admirable target of holding the referendum on the 50th anniversary of the successful 1967 referendum, which took the first steps in removing discrimination against Indigenous peoples contained in the Constitution. That anniversary is this May. And sadly, we won't be seeing a referendum happen then. In fact, to me, it seems unlikely any time this year. In his 2 years as Prime Minister, despite describing himself as the, quote, first Prime Minister for Aboriginal Affairs, unquote, that was Mr Abbott's self-description, Tony Abbott did not provide the strong leadership which was needed. I think he's more likely to be remembered for cutting $500 million out of the Commonwealth's Aboriginal Affairs programs than for anything else. Even the way that Abbott spoke of the recognition referendum as, and this was his phrase, completing the constitution, not changing it, was actually completely unhelpful. It may have meant something to right-wing conservatives in his own party, but to most Australians, a referendum is for changing the constitution. The founding fathers, they're all men, put section 128 in the constitution for a reason. It was so that the constitution could be changed to meet changing circumstances in Australian society as they arose. Now, I just want to make a few comments about the content of this referendum too. It's likely that a referendum that goes beyond what's been called a minimalist position will seek to do two main things, one symbolic and one practical. Just on the minimalist position, there was some news coverage last week of what's been happening in the Indigenous consultation that is underway as we sit here. It's been underway since late last year and it'll be concluded in May. My personal view is not what's going to determine this, but personally, I was pleased to see the reports coming out of that Indigenous consultation to the effect that a minimalist position will not cut it. We had a little playing with this by Howard back in 1999 when we had that accompanying the Republic referendum. We were asked to express an opinion about a preamble drafted by Les Murray. That wasn't good enough then, and it won't be good enough now. There is no point in the vast effort that is being spent on this project if all we end up with is some minimalist position. And I'm happy to see those expressions of at least a tentative view coming out of this Indigenous consultation that the minimalist position will not cut it. But as I said, if we get beyond that, and I sincerely hope we will, there will be two main things, a symbolic and a practical outcome. It's likely that the proposed changes will seek to make specific mention of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders in the Constitution and acknowledge Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples as the first peoples of our land. You're probably all sitting there thinking, why on earth doesn't it already say that? Indeed, why didn't it say that when it was drafted in 1901? Because it's not something that we've suddenly discovered. Captain Cook worked it out when he arrived. Arthur Phillip worked it out when he arrived in 1788, 18 years after Cook. And the people that gave the instructions to Governor Arthur Phillip when he came here with the first fleet gave him instructions about the first peoples of our land. But for whatever reason, we have no acknowledgement of the first peoples of this land in our constitution. And that's, if you like, the symbolic thing that should happen. It's a very important step on the long road to reconciliation. It's a change that at one level is symbolic in seeking to address historic elements of our constitution, which are to modernise very like racism. But symbols are important in politics, and the right symbols can help to change perceptions in a way that paves the way for changes of a more practical kind. The second part of what I would hope to see in a referendum could focus on more substantive change to our constitution. It's truly unacceptable that the founding laws of this country allow the federal parliament to make laws that discriminate against Australians adversely on the basis of race. This was necessary, according to former Prime Minister Edmund Barton, our first Prime Minister, speaking from his colonial position in 1898, when he said this: We need to regulate, this is a direct quote, regulate the affairs of the people of coloured or inferior races who are in the Commonwealth, unquote. So that's the spirit in which the Constitution was drafted. We have truly come a long way since then, and we need to make the document speak of who we are today, not of what we were or what Australia was of the white men who drafted this document in 1898 and 1899 and 1900, but of who we are today. To go back to the expert panel's suggestions, the expert panel proposed that the races power, which is section 5126, be deleted so as to remove the ability to pass laws that discriminate against Indigenous people adversely. They recommended instead that there should be a new section 51A in the Constitution that would recognise Indigenous peoples and preserve the Australian government's ability to pass laws for the benefit of Indigenous people. It also seems likely that constitutional recognition would involve the removal of section 25(2), which recognises that the states can ban people from voting on the basis of their race. I'll bet there's people in this room that are shocked to learn that in section 25, subsection 2 of the Australian Constitution, there is still a provision that says that if a state makes a law that prohibits a person of any race from voting, that person doesn't get to vote in a Commonwealth election. Now, you might think it's not that likely that in 2017 or any time soon, a state could legislate in that manner, but nevertheless, it's a shocking thing that that provision is still in our Constitution and it ought to be removed. What the expert panel said about this in diplomatic language, they recommended its repeal on the basis that it would, quote, contribute to a more unified and reconciled nation. The expert panel had a couple of other suggestions. One was adopting a new section 116, capital A, prohibiting governments from passing laws that discriminate on the basis of race, and also inserting a new section 127, capital A, recognising Indigenous languages were this country's first tongues, while confirming that English is Australia's national language. Following on from the expert panel's report, some of those changes were met with resistance, and that's why the Parliamentary Joint Select Committee on Constitutional Recognition of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples was set up, again, to assess these proposals and to consider options for addressing any issues with the expert panel's proposals. I'm not going to spend time going over the slightly different way in which that Parliamentary Joint Select Committee produced its recommendations, but certainly it was a long way past minimalist, and I'll leave it at that. There is general agreement that change must happen. There is general agreement that change is well overdue. The push for this referendum is bipartisan. In fact, it is deemed so important that this referendum passes that the only question is how to get the referendum process absolutely right. The Referendum Council, of which Senator Dodson was a member before he entered the Parliament in April last year, is now charged with preparing the framework for the referendum. The reporting date for their proposals has shifted. Hopefully, they will be reporting on the 30th of June this year. The Indigenous consultation process, which is going to feed into the Referendum Council's report, is well underway. It'll end at Uluru in May, actually on the 50th anniversary of the 1967 referendum, with the National Indigenous Constitution Convention, itself a historic event. And I hope that a settled proposal for the referendum emerges from that Indigenous consultation process that is underway now, and that we get a report from the Referendum Council on the 30th of June, with which the national leadership, meaning the government and the opposition working together, can go forward. The danger that I'm concerned about is that the sense of urgency to have this matter dealt with will be lost, and the momentum that we've achieved as the result of tireless community action and activism will not bear fruit. Without political leadership, we risk missing the opportunity that is now presenting to us to have the unjust and unfair state of our constitution finally dealt with. Once the council's proposals are put forward, I hope that the government, and particularly the Prime Minister, gives them the serious attention that the issue deserves. I hope a date is set for a referendum that is considered immovable so that the Yes campaign can begin in earnest and ensure the highest possible degree of success for this referendum. It's too important a question to fail. We will not know the precise shape of this referendum until after the council reports later this year. The Prime Minister has claimed that he is committed to constitutional recognition. I hope that for once he surprises us and makes that commitment real. As I've said, we won't succeed without leadership on this issue. Bill Shorten and the entire Labor team are committed to working with the Turnbull government, and I don't use that phrase that often, I'll say it again. Bill Shorten and the entire Labor team are committed to working with the Turnbull government to lead the national debate that lies ahead of us. Thanks very much.